prolific in producing. It creates breathtaking, large-scale mixed media art and uses storytelling and stylized renditions of fundamental scenes of love, loss, freedom, survival, activism, and living history. His work has graced the cover of Elle Weekly. He's exhibited at Art Basel in Miami, the Coachella Arts and Music Festival, and he's been featured on CNN and the Huffington Post, Extra TV, Ebony Magazine, and much more. He received global recognition for his Better Days Ahead piece and campaign, his collaboration with Volcom. He is in the permanent collection of the Intel Corporation, the Smithsonian National Museum of American Art, African-American History and Culture. His work is at the California African-American Museum and Senegal's Musée Bourandar, and much more. He also creates eye-catching, timeless, hand-painted wearable art, which I had my piece on. And that's alongside his larger canvas work. Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Regis.
Well, it is certainly an honor to be moderating this talk at Carla House, whose incredible work we're here to celebrate. Let's give her a hand.
didn't know how difficult it was. You know, I kind of went in a little bit blind. I didn't know enough about it to make their scare. I just kind of thought I was like applying to anything else, you know? And New York is like a good place, I think, because there are so many like schools and programs there. You know, I did a lot of like, for example, school visual art has a really great kind of co-educational program, like an adult education program. But I'm just kind of taking classes there, here or there, working on a portfolio. I got to really kind of, through that process, work with a lot of really amazing artists that, you know, maybe I would not have had exposure to otherwise, you know, just go and sign up. Saturday morning photography class, and since they're in New York, it's like that represents what I'm rolling out, you know? And so just working with them and taking classes here and there, and just kind of spending more and more time on it as time went on, you know, I could do the portfolio and just start to get applications and I got to get into the
Big job from New York.
Yeah, yes.
So working already for New York. Were you showing as well, like doing gallery shows or?
I was doing like little pop-up shows, you know, I did have friends that were artists, and so we were occasionally doing like artist-run shows, you know, I had a few kind of like group shows and like smaller galleries, and so I was just on a show here or there, but I wasn't really, I guess I was kind of like a quote-unquote outsider artist at that point, but I didn't really get inside until like after UCLA.
So you went to UCLA, and yeah. You moved to Los Angeles and you're inside.
Yeah.
very, very interesting journey. So how different was the New York sort of art scene in comparison to this new world that you are launching into, MFA in Los Angeles? Mm-hmm. What was that transition into sort of the gallery world like?
mapping out what I want the pieces to look like, what I want the story behind them to be. And so before I ever go to like a piece of paper, I already have in my mind like an idea of what I want it to look like. So the process is pretty much the same when I do all my more recent works, right? I shoot the models in the studio first. Some of them are friends, some of them are family. I'll do the subjects in the studio and get the green screen, and then I scan them into the computer and I build sort of digital worlds around them. But that's all after I've already like mapped out really kind of what I want the project to be about, what the concept is, and what the story would be for all the pieces.
Is that the case with all of them? Like, do you photograph here with the subjects? Like, we go through all the work here.
It is. And actually, if you look at my reviews, I have that little group of people that like I work with all the time, you know, like once a year, twice a year, I'll put together in the studio. We just do a bunch of different shots, different setups, different stories, you know. And then once I kind of collect it all together, you know, then I kind of go and kind of add people to here or there and some maps and stuff like that. It's kind of, in a way, this work is kind of a lot like making a collage, and that I take all the pieces of the people. And then I draw all the landscapes, and I, you know, do all the textures and the color, and I kind of put it all together, you know, we smash it all together into individual work.
That's great. Connection with your own community, mm-hmm. and so transparent, so the canvas.
Yes.
So speaking of community, I see that you are sort of leaning towards a lot of public art mm-hmm. projects. Tell us a little bit about what you have coming up and what you've recently been working on.
Sure, yeah.
In that space.
So also in 2020, I did my very first kind of public art project, a big mural for the city of Los Angeles over in Whitaker at Magic Johnson Park. And that I think was really interesting as well. I feel like there are a lot of similar elements between like my gallery work and my public art work. But public art is, I mean, it's like really interesting because it's even more engaging the community, you know, because it lives in the community and like there's an opportunity to like speak with like people, different groups, representatives from like people who actually live in that place, in that space, and like and people engage with the work in a much different way. So I think even though like the way of making the work, like the process is similar, like the way that I think about it is different because it just has a totally different purpose.
Absolutely. How did you land that opportunity? It seems like an amazing opportunity. Is that something you go seek or do they go push you? Or how did that particular one?
They helped me actually.
Okay.
Yeah, I did. Apparently someone that I worked with in the past like recommended me. And so they reached out, asked me to submit an application, and then it was me and like four other artists, and they liked my proposal and concept. So that's how
And I'm sure that's the first of many. Are there any others in the works at the moment that you can speak about, of course?
Yeah, I work on a new project. I work on a few other ones up in Oakland. And then another piece coming out for the city of Pasadena. So public art has become this whole new thing that I'm like really interested in and like doing more and more.
I love that.
Yeah.
And as you land these public art opportunities, how deep do you dive within each, like let's say the Pasadena situation, what is that process like for you? Just, you know, okay, so I land this opportunity. How do you go about creating that particular community?
There's a really heavy kind of research component attached to it. So like I'm spending this whole year like doing, like working with like the city of Pasadena, working with like their library system, meeting with different organizations, different sort of representatives from the local community there. So it's really important to that their stories are presented in the work. I feel like whereas the stuff I make for the gallery is all mostly my idea, the stuff I make for a public art space is like a group project. You know, like even though it's my hands making the work, like their history and their ideas and like the way that they want to represent it has to be kind of built into it, which is a pretty important element. Yeah.
And are you allowed the freedom to sort of
would make sense for this space and what doesn't. And so I think as long as that happens, we're good to go. Like I would, they wouldn't pick someone they knew would make something that would make sense. Yes. Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about your use of folklore in your work. I know traditionally that's been something that's been a huge part of your process. Mm-hmm. Do you get a chance to also include that with the public art work? Is this something you want to include? Do you keep it separate?
I think in the way that I look at kind of local history, or maybe urban legend, and kind of incorporate that into the public artwork. But I think I don't necessarily pull from other cultures or other places in the world. Whereas with my gallery work, I kind of, the world is open. Whatever it passes my fancy at that given time, I kind of can dive into. But I think public art really needs to be about that particular community. Yeah.
And for your gallery and museum work in the future, is folklore going to be something that you continue to work on? I know we talked a little bit about that.
Yeah. The answer is I don't know. I've been like doing work that's inspired by mythology and folklore for like the past, since I left grad school, Something that I was really passionate about, I've been passionate about, but I don't know if I still am. So I don't know, we'll see what comes up next year.
That's one thing that we have in common. We're working on for a lot of our Trinidad and folklore. Quite recently I did a DNA test and realized that I was Nigerian. Lineage, and so I started reading up on Nigerian mythology. So it's really interesting. It's like, do I want to dive in deeper, or maybe I've done it? But that's the most interesting thing about being an artist. You're sort of, you never know what's next.
Yeah, you never know what's next. Yeah, and you have the freedom to kind of change and pivot.
Another thing that we have in common is collage work. And is that something that you plan on continuing to do?
Yeah, I feel like it took me a while to really find a way of working that I really loved. So now, at the process at least, I really enjoy. So I don't see myself like pivoting away from this style of work. We just kind of explain other concepts or different subject matter.
And in terms of, this is sort of like behind the scenes stuff that artists were talking about. And in terms of like sales and success and stuff like that. I know for me in particular, collage work sort of sells. So there are different styles that I do, but the collage work seems to be really trendy right now. Mm-hmm. That's been selling. So that sort of influences what I create. As an artist, do you think like that? Is there a drive to be commercially successful and create as much commercially successful work, or is it more about feeding your soul, creating stuff from the heart, more than it's a fine balance?
Yeah, I agree with that. It's like a balance, And I think that's kind of the upside of doing gallery work and public work and commercial work, that I have a little bit more freedom, I think, where if something isn't selling, I don't have to abandon it completely, but I have other things that are bringing in income. So I think that's a place I like to be in. People ask me, are you still doing commercial work? Or are you still doing income? That's why. Because that way, if I can kind of keep my artwork and the value of love, and I don't have to make it about making rent.
It's a powerful place to be.
doing more of that, besides being part of this show. I also, I used to curate a little bit. I had a few events, a few shows that I did like years ago. I haven't been in a while, so maybe doing some more of that.
And I see all of that. And I guess I wasn't sure if we're going to open it up to the floor for questions.
Yes, absolutely.
I think this would be a really good time to sort of turn to you and see if there were questions that you had.
First of all, we just got to leave.
Yes, questions.
You said that the folklore and stories that influence the art, including the pieces that are lost. I mean, maybe could we hear some of the stories that go into these pieces that were in there today?
Well, this particular body of work was inspired by. This one isn't going to be about a folktale. I feel like here this is kind of a bit of an anomaly because, like I said, it was made during the pandemic, so it's more about kind of the environment. In other pieces, I've done a lot of work inspired by Greco Roman mythology, like Greek myths, Romans. And then my most recent work, like this piece here at the end, that's the newest piece in the series, and that's from a part of the series where I'm like making my own pantheon of gods.
And what is she the goddess of?
More than a question, I want to let everyone know in this room that the UCLA Masters in Fine Arts is the number one rated Masters in Fine Arts in the world. So it's quite a feat. When you say that very humbly, it's quite impressive. I have a question. What's your next big project, museum or gallery or project? Do you have something you're working on besides Pasadena?
So I have another project. It's a collaboration where I'm making these series of installations. I'm on year 3 of it. I don't have some of it here, but it's 5 installations. It's a collaboration with a historian, and each installation represents a different era of Black history. Right. And so we've done 2 so far. We've done the Jim Crow era and the Middle Passage, and so now we're working on a piece inspired by Afrofuturism. What's next in Black culture? And so that's what I'm working on in addition to that.
Does that affect you emotionally, or how do you handle that? Because that's kind of very tough, isn't it?
It is a little bit, but I feel like I've been working with it so long, I'm a little bit not numb to it, but like it doesn't impact me as is affecting me as much as what's in the material. Yeah, and I think working with a historian and having it be very research based helps me to intellectualize it as well.
Where are these installations?
I've had 2 of them shown here now. The first one was at this gallery in Santa Monica, one was at Art Space in Milan. So basically, we're right in time space. Yeah, we're right in time space. And my big goal is to show all 5 of them together in one space. Yeah, but so we're working on the 3rd one now. And then we've got 2 years to make the next 2. The 3rd one I have actually a
bigger
space.
What other parts would you give to this inspired artist?
Share your work. You know, I feel like a lot of things that I have come my way, you know, just been me putting things on Instagram and like someone seeing them and really connecting with it. I feel like a lot of young artists I talk to, like, feel like they have to have things perfected or at a certain level or have to, you know, have a certain audience or to be able to share their work. And I really, you know, through sharing your work, that's how you get to that next level. So I just like the best is to keep making work and just keep sharing it and showing it to everyone and anyone that you can.
I second that. Let's never share it. Instagram is free.
Yeah.
Is there a particular time of the day, a location, or a time of the year where you feel more creatively inspired?
I'm not a morning person. So I tend to work at night. And, you know, I like peace and quiet too. I think I need like dance on to concentrate. So I have a habit of like too.